Thank you, Professor Shima, for the very nice introduction, and also thank you for extending the invitation to give the Chuhel lecture. And thankfully, I think the rain's about to stop, but just in case in the back, can everybody hear me at this level of volume? Good. So the talk that I wanted to give today over the next 30-40 minutes is entitled Misunderstanding the Role of the Rate of Interest as a Source of Today's Monetary Mismanagement. The reason why I wanted to give this talk is because interest rates figure heavily or centrally in both mainstream monetary analysis and Austrian monetary and macroeconomic analysis, except we differ greatly on many issues, and so I wanted to compare and contrast them and give set the record straight, so to speak. And so just as a way of brief introduction, when we talk about mainstream monetary analysis, the way that they treat the rate of interest falls into several camps. In the standard New Keynesian framework, the rate of interest is just an interest rate that balances investment savings equilibrium with full employment output. In Michael Woodford's Interest and Prices, which is now kind of the workhorse for graduate level monetary economics, the rate of interest and what he calls the natural rate of interest is the rate of interest that discourages firms from changing prices, so it's more of a microeconomic view of things. John Taylor, of course, is very famous for the Taylor rule, and the rate of interest, the equilibrium rate of interest for him, is just one that balances unemployment and inflation, so keeping unemployment relatively low and inflation also relatively low. And even in finance theory, we can see peculiar ways that the rate of interest is treated. Typically, we would treat the rate of interest there as just a hurdle rate against which we would gauge the profitability of certain investments to determine whether they are feasible or not. And curiously enough, when the mainstream talks about the rate of interest as a variable that equilibrates a macroeconomic system, it's really only a tool to guide output. And the only constraint in any real sense of the world they have on the rate of interest is its ability to change the rate of inflation. So, of course, too low a rate of interest will encourage inflation. They understand that. And is not desirable in and of itself. This is even strange compared to the relatively recent history whereby the zero lower bound, the idea that an interest rate of zero was as low as they could go, was also acting as a constraint on the interest rate. And also absent in the mainstream's use of the rate of interest as a variable to equilibrate an economy is that there is no discussion as to whether the output or the income, which is being adjusted by a rate of interest, is sustainable or not. So in mainstream macroeconomic analysis, there isn't really attention afforded to whether a boom or an economy is functioning sustainably, whether economic growth is sustainable or not, what role the interest rate plays in that. And of course, then when a bust or a recession happens, there's also no discussion of whether the interest rate during the boom years was responsible for the bust. Now, this is in contrast to the Austrian school of economics, where the rate of interest and its emphasis on economic growth has always been at the forefront. In fact, for Austrians, business cycle theory development is very special because it was an outgrowth of a general theory of economic growth. The emphasis on general economic growth theory was always whether it was sustainable or not. And in particular, when Austrian school economic growth theory was first developing, there was attention afforded to the constraints that an economy or that individual firms would have. And in this talk, really the majority of it, I want to give a rundown of the two different types of constraints that Austrian school economists talk about when we discuss economic growth, then discuss how they dovetail together, and then maybe give a refinement to them as we get towards the end. The first such constraint that Austrian school economists used was known as the subsistence fund, the idea that any long-dated investment project would require some saved resources ahead of time to sustain its workers and capitalists until the production process was complete. And then more commonly today, when we speak about a constraint in macroeconomic growth, we refer to a natural rate of interest, which is also, curiously enough, one that the mainstream focuses on, but in a different way than the Austrian school does. So to start with the idea of the subsistence fund. Going back in time to the classical British economists, the idea of a wages fund was fairly central to their economic doctrines. The wages fund was the idea that in any long production process, it would take time before the efforts of workers in the present matured into consumable output in the future. And in order to sustain workers and to pay them until the fruits of their labor were apparent, some pre-saved resources were necessary to pay them out. The doctrine of the wages fund is that in a nutshell. And to give you a fairly textbook example, if the production of wheat takes 1 year, you employ workers in the present for 1 year to grow wheat, except you don't have any output which you could use to pay them until 1 year from now. And so before the production process takes place, you need to have a saved pool of resources from which you will tap into to pay your employees during that year until they actually produce consumable output. This was popularized in many ways. Maybe a culmination of it was William Stanley Jevons' sunspot theory of the business cycle later in the 19th century, where Jevons offered that sunspots, the vicissitudes of the sun's energy coming at Earth, was the primary determinant of whether a crop or a harvest would be successful or not, and so that would be an origin of the business cycle. It was Eugen von Bombawerk who channeled this self-evident truth of the wages fund and reformulated it into a simple growth model. And in doing so, he posed two challenges to the classical economists. The first was the belief that production processes are of a fixed duration, typically assumed to be 1 year. Of course, Bombawerk was able to show that, and it's obviously true, that production processes are not only of various lengths, but also that they're synchronous. In other words, the fruits of one production process may mature today, while at the same point in time a new production process commences. At the same time, Bombawerk was able to show that the output of any production process is not just consumable goods, something that could be used to pay their employees, but could actually be capital goods that are then reintegrated into the production process to help it along. Now, Bombawerk might be most famous for his proof that longer production processes, those production processes that take a longer duration or period of time, would only be used once shorter processes of equal productivity had been exhausted. And to take the corollary of that, which is the way it's more popularized today, the theory is more popularized, it's that more output can only be achieved through longer production processes. Of course, we exhaust the shorter, most productive processes to completion, and then we have to move on to longer duration ones. But then to couple this with the idea of the wages fund doctrine from the classical economists, Bombawerk was able to show that these longer processes also required a larger degree of pre-saved resources in order to be successfully completed. And since these longer production processes themselves are more productive, it became true that economic growth attained through longer production processes would only be achieved if we had a sufficient amount of pre-saved resources available to see them through to completion. It's quite similar to the wages fund doctrine. In fact, superficially it seems to be the same thing, in the sense that we need pre-saved resources to sustain workers until our output is produced, and that the output that is produced must be in a consumable form. But Bombawerk sets his theory, differentiates his theory somewhat, because first of all, he renames the wages fund doctrine as the subsistence fund doctrine. Subsistence was used as an adjective for him to denote the fact that we're not just concerned with keeping our wage earners, our workers, sustained throughout the production process, we're also concerned with remunerating our capitalists and our landowners as well. So wages seems to denote that it's only workers that we're concerned with, laborers. We need a more all-encompassing adjective, subsistence fund. In simple expositions of Austrian business cycle theory, we use this analogy that Bombawerk developed. And to use one which is probably familiar to many of you, when Robinson Crusoe washes up on the desert island with no resources, and he has nothing to his name, and he starts living hand-to-mouth, so picking berries off trees, and this is how he's keeping himself alive. And Robinson Crusoe realizes that the only way that he can have economic development or make his life better is if he becomes better at picking berries. The only problem with picking berries is he's spending all of his time doing that, and in order to make himself more productive, he needs a capital good, like a stick or a ladder to climb up higher in a tree or something of that nature. And in order to spend time producing a better stick or finding a better stick or producing a ladder, he would need to take time away from producing berries. And he needs all the berries he can get just to stay alive. And so the simple truth in this example is that Robinson Crusoe needs to set aside, reduce his consumption and set aside a stockpile of berries ahead of time, which he can then use to eat to stay alive during a production process to produce a capital good, a stick or a ladder. And so he reduces his consumption, He saves more berries ahead of time. And then he chooses a day or a morning where he's going to search around the island for a stick or build a ladder or something like that, and he eats the berries to stay alive while he's exerting those efforts. And if all goes well, his pre-saved supply of berries will be sufficient to feed him while he's developing his stick. And at the end of the day, he'll have a stick to reach the more fecund higher branches, have a more ample supply of berries, and this would be economic growth. When we look at this simple example, the subsistence fund seems evident. The curtailment of consumption that Robinson Crusoe has to do at the beginning of the example frees up berries or savings that are going to keep him alive during the long-dated production process. Now, by the time we get to Ludwig von Mises in his theory of money and credit in 1912, Mises ascribes the bust in different ways than von Bawerk would describe a lack of economic growth. For Mises, it's not the lack of the means of subsistence per se that causes an economic recession, but it is unsustainable changes to the production structure, which reduce the flow of goods which would replenish the subsistence fund. And what Mises is able to achieve through this slight shift is to change the subsistence fund from a stock variable, a pre-saved amount of berries or a pre-saved amount of consumable goods, into a flow variable. It's not that we need enough goods saved ahead of time, it's that we need a production structure that continually yields a sufficient amount of goods to replenish the diminished subsistence fund. And in Mises' theory of the business cycle, at least in his theory in Money and Credit, he puts forward that entrepreneurs are fooled into thinking that the subsistence fund has been increased when really it has not. And when entrepreneurs are fooled into thinking that the subsistence fund has increased, they are led to start undertaking longer dated production processes, which will also be more productive, or presumably so. However, since the pre-saved supply of resources, the subsistence fund has not actually increased, the economy lacks the resources to see these long-dated investment projects through to completion. Mises comments that the economic bust will result in a realignment of what he calls, or what is known as, the structure of production. So the economic bust is not a bad thing in some sense of the word, it's just the economy realigning itself to people's savings preferences that existed before the bust set in. And he gives two ways that this could happen. One is that some investments that had been undertaken will have to be abandoned, or at least substituted for less productive but shorter duration ends. So in other words, stretch out the subsistence fund that you have long enough to complete whatever projects you can. Or alternatively, the bust could happen with consumers needing to realign their savings preferences with the needs of the economy. In other words, consumers will have to cut back on consumption and start saving more in order to replenish the depleted subsistence fund. Mises later in Human Action gives an analogy which is very popular, which illustrates his thinking on the matter. It's his master builder example, which I assume many people are familiar with. In the master builder example from Human Action, Mises puts forward an example where entrepreneurs in the construction industry and the home building industry are fooled into thinking that there are more bricks and resources necessary to build houses than there actually are in existence. And so under this foolish expectation, they undertake the production of more houses than there are bricks available to complete. And when the economy, or when the construction workers, come to the realization that there's an insufficient supply of bricks, the recession sets in. The recession sets in the sense that some houses will not get built because there's not enough bricks to actually complete them, or that some houses will even need to be torn down in order to free up bricks to use on the other houses and to complete them. Here the binding resource constraint that Mises uses is somewhat similar to the one that von Bawerk would have developed in his subsistence fund, and that the classical British economist would have used earlier in the wages fund, though it's slightly different. Because previously for von Bawerk and for the British classical school, the resources that had to be saved were always of a consumable form. In other words, the subsistence fund and the wages fund were both consumable goods that were pre-saved. In Mises' master builder example, it's not consumption goods, but capital goods, bricks. And capital goods are notable as being the produced means of production. In his example, there's a problem that develops, because if the house building industry ever had a lack of bricks, we could just produce more bricks to relax the resource constraint. It's not binding in any sense of the word. Of course, if we had a lack of bricks, we would expect the price of bricks to also increase. But the price of bricks increasing, since they're an input in the home building industry, would cause profits to be reduced over there. but would also cause a corresponding rise in profits in the brick building industry. In other words, one sector of the economy busts turns into the other sector of the economy's gain or profits. And we don't see a general economic crisis developing or a general economic bust. We see sector-specific busts and booms developing, but that's not what the business cycle is all about, because the gist of the business cycle is, why do all production processes suffer at the same time? Why do all industries face the same economic problems? Now, to summarize the subsistence fund and where we are right now at the end of Mises' use for it, the subsistence fund works very well describing economic business cycles in simple agrarian type economies, like the Robinson Crusoe example, or the predominantly agrarian economies that the British classical school were describing. It works, the subsistence fund works as an analogy or as a metaphor to describe the business cycle in more industrialized economies, but there's some disagreement as to what the fund should actually hold, whether it's only consumption goods that are pre-saved or whether capital goods, like in that example that I gave you with Mises, should also play a role. And then we get to more financial economies where things get trickier yet. Because in financial economies, capital, borrowing, and investment is never funded in terms of real savings, but it meets in its monetary form. And if there's a dearth of monetary savings, it could be the central bank could be able to create new savings out of thin air and thus replenish the subsistence fund. And so as a metaphor, the subsistence fund fell out of favor and had difficulties describing macroeconomic business cycles in more financial economies, mostly in the early 20th century. Now, Mises, early on, as far back as the theory of money and credit, realized this difficulty. The difficulty of using the subsistence fund to describe a resource constraint in business cycles. He realized the difficulty by noting that even though we understand this intuitively, we must have resources saved up to complete a production process, no entrepreneur seems to consider such a thing as a subsistence fund when they make their production plans. There is no factor out there called the subsistence fund that anybody keeps track of. And since entrepreneurs are not guided by a subsistence fund, Mises has to seek out an alternative that he can use to describe the business cycle. The alternative, famously, that he builds upon is Knut Wicksell's then fairly new idea of the natural rate of interest as a way to provide the missing link, the link between the business cycle and the fund of pre-saved resources necessary to complete long-dated production processes. Knut Wicksell, the Swedish economist, in 1898 publishes Interest and Prices. And Knut's emphasis is on providing a link between the rate of interest and the general price level in the economy. In other words, seeing in what way, if any, inflation or deflationary conditions are affected by the rate of interest. He also seeks to find out in what way the causality runs. And furthermore, if the interest rate in the economy diverged from, let's say, a natural equilibrium level, what would be the effect on prices in general? And his great conclusion in that book, which is accepted today by not just Austrian school economists, but also many mainstream economists, as we'll get to later on in the lecture, is to conclude that there exists a natural rate of interest which would be neutral with respect to the general price level in the economy. This natural rate of interest is neutral with respect to the general price level because it's the rate of interest that balances the demand for investment with the supply of savings, so maintains savings-investment equilibrium. And if the economy had an interest rate which was at this natural level, the general price level would neither be lowered nor raised. He defines this natural rate of interest as that which would exist if capital goods were lent and borrowed in kind in their natural form, or in other words, without the intermediation of money. So a real rate of interest, I suppose we could define it as. Wicksell furthermore defines what he calls a cumulative process of price inflation to show how it is that the rate of interest affects general prices. He contrasts the natural rate of interest that would exist if capital goods met in their natural form, so without money, with the market or money rate of interest that actually exists in the economy. In the case where the market rate of interest is lower than the natural rate, the demand for investment would be greater than the supply of savings. Entrepreneurs would bid up the prices of capital goods because they're relatively scarce. And this bidding up in the price of capital goods would cause the general price level of all goods in the economy to increase. in the corollary, the opposite case, if the market rate of interest was set above the natural rate of interest, the opposite would occur. There would be a dearth of investment demand. The prices of investment or capital goods would have to fall to clear the market, and that would cause general prices in the economy to fall as well. Now, for Knut Wicksell, the emphasis then fell on what would cause the market rate of interest to diverge from this natural rate of interest. And he points his finger to the market, to the banking system. Because, of course, in any fractional reserve banking system, banks have the ability to change the amount of loanable funds and thus affect the market rate of interest, normally affecting it by lowering it. There's similarities between Wicksell's rendition of this relationship between interest rates and prices and the quantity theory of money. Because after all, both theories focus on changes to the money supply and how they affect the general price level. In the quantity theory of money, the effect or the relationship is direct. Increases in the money supply cause increases in the general price level and vice versa. In Wicksell's theory, changes to the money supply affect the market rate of interest, which then goes on to affect the savings investment balance and cause inflation or deflationary conditions. But Wicksell makes a very nice contribution because in the quantity theory, there's no bound on what inflation, what level of inflation we can have, except for the monetary authority's restraint in changing the money supply. In other words, as long as you have a central bank which is willing to accommodate higher and higher rates of monetary growth, you will always have higher and higher rates of inflation. For Wicksell, there's two reasons why this might not be the case. The first is that since it is private banks, fractional reserve banks, that are reducing their market rate of interest below the natural rate, in doing so, they would cause an increase in investment demand, and people would go to banks to borrow at these artificially low rates. But of course, as private investors go and borrow from banks, private banks are constrained by their reserve balances. And as they have to use up their reserve balances, they'll find themselves constrained. If they ran out of reserves, of course, then the private banks would be forced into a situation where they need to increase the private rate of interest to demotivate private investors from borrowing further from them. Alternatively, Wicksell comments that as this inflationary process continues and more investments are exploited, the return on newly invested capital will decrease. And as it decreases, this also demotivates investors from wanting to borrow more money from banks. This decrease in investment demand will cause downward pressure on the market rate of interest. And as the market rate of interest converges back down to the natural rate, inflationary pressures would subside. Mises uses this idea of the natural rate of interest as a surrogate or as a signal to denote the size of the subsistence fund necessary in his business cycle theory. He uses Knut Wicksell's definition of the natural rate of interest as the rate of interest that would exist if capital goods met on the market in their own kind, in other words, without money, so a real rate of interest. In Mises' theory, it is the size of the subsistence fund that determines the level of the natural rate of interest, and therefore, the greater the subsistence fund, the lower the natural rate of interest, and the more longer-dated production processes can be successfully undertaken. In other words, a greater subsistence fund will result through the signal provided by the natural rate of interest with a growing economy, and furthermore, a sustainably growing economy. Mises' great contribution, which wasn't even what he was trying to do, but his great contribution in the theory of money and credit was combining Eugen von Bombawerk's general theory of economic growth based on the idea of the subsistence fund with Knut Wicksell's natural rate of interest to provide the missing link between the two. There must be some kind of resource constraint that constrains economic growth in general. But no individual knows what this constraint is. We can't see the subsistence fund, we can't purchase it, and we can't purchase from it. No entrepreneur considers it, but every entrepreneur considers the rate of interest. So Mises, by making the link between the rate of interest as being determined by the subsistence fund, allowed us to understand how it is that entrepreneurs could gauge what the correct duration of investment project is to undertake. The appeal to Mises' achievement is twofold. The first is that we gave a source to entrepreneurial error that was something that entrepreneurs actually consider. Because originally, the source of entrepreneurial error was misjudging the size of the subsistence fund. But this is tough to hold against anyone, given that nobody really considers what the subsistence fund is. Better to say that we have been misguided about the size of the subsistence fund because of false signals through the rate of interest. The second great contribution is in showing that the economic recession or the bust is not caused by too much investment, but rather the wrong types of investments, and in particular Mises' focus on too long-dated investment projects. In other words, the time structure of production is skewed in an unsustainable way. Now, when we get to Friedrich von Hayek, his contribution was, on top of Mises' understanding of the business cycle, was in shifting the attention away from changes to the general price level, but focusing on relative prices, in particular the price of capital goods to consumer goods. Of course, if we go back in time, Knut Wicksell, in developing the natural interest rate hypothesis, was never concerned with relative prices. He commented briefly on them, but his emphasis was on the general rate of inflation. And even Mises, in the theory of money and credit, the first and foremost, he was trying to describe why and from where money gets its value. Of course, money getting its value is just the other side of the coin from the rate of inflation, or the purchasing power of money. But even Mises was not concerned with relative prices as such. And so Hayek was the first to really give a comprehensive description of why relative prices matter. He was also able to refine Knut Wicksell's natural rate hypothesis in some very important ways. First and foremost is this idea that for Wicksell, if the market rate of interest was the exact same as the natural rate of interest, the price level would remain constant, there would be no inflation or deflation. But Hayek was able to show in his monetary theory in the trade cycle in 1933 that as long as we had net investment taking place at the natural rate of interest, there would be economic growth putting downward pressure on prices. In other words, a growing economy should have deflation or falling prices as the norm, which is in stark contrast to the general understanding that the mainstream economists would have today. However, even Hayek's analysis and his reliance on the natural rate of interest ran into some difficulties. The difficulties mostly came to the front during Piero Sraffa's reviews of prices and production shortly after its publication. And I want to go through three primary criticisms that Sraffa gave of Hayek to see why they're important. And the first and the most famous criticism directly attacked the idea of the natural rate of interest, and more specifically that there is one unique natural rate of interest that permeates the economy. Sraffa, in his initial review, showed that the natural rate of interest is just the difference between a spot and a forward price for a commodity, and that as a result, there will be as many natural rates of interest as there are commodities in the economy. This criticism is today known as the multiple natural rates of interest hypothesis, and it's quite popular, this idea that there isn't just a unique natural rate of interest that has to be targeted by someone, whether it's the central bank or a private monetary system, but that there's multiple natural rates of interest that need to be addressed. Sraffa more damagingly attacked Hayek by using an equilibrium that would obtain in a barter economy as a foil from which to compare the conditions that would exist in a monetary economy. And by that, what Sraffa meant was that the natural rate of interest is one that would emerge if capital goods were exchanged in kind without money. In other words, under barter conditions. And so Hayek starts by describing what would happen in a barter economy and what equilibrium would look like, and then extrapolates that that must be the exact same conditions that would breed monetary stability in the monetary economy. But making a leap like that is not without difficulties for many reasons. On a more methodological level, and this is the criticism which Hayek took more to heart, Sraffa criticized Hayek because Hayek had previously insisted that any solid monetary theory would have to start from conditions of neutral money, would have to assume that money was neutral. But in Sraffa's broader criticism of Hayek, there are good reasons to doubt why money would be neutral even in the barter economy, and so Hayek uses, even under his own standard, an inapplicable way to pursue monetary theory or monetary analysis. Hayek was greatly affected by this review for many reasons. But on the economic side of things, Hayek, in his response to the review, downplayed the importance of the multiple natural rates of interest hypothesis. He didn't see the criticism as being that important to his broader analysis, and he commented that while accepting that there would be multiple natural rates of interest in the economy, they would all be acceptable and they would all be equilibrium rates of interest. Of course, this only allowed Sraffa to make his rebuttal in his famous rejoinder, and Sraffa at this point was boxing clever and put Hayek in a bit of a corner because he said, even if you accept then if there are multiple natural rates of interest, this creates the next problem on what to do. We could either try to target every natural rate of interest, which is of course not possible, or we could try to average out all of these natural rates of interest to figure out which one we need to target for monetary stability. But of course, this latter response is not possible for Hayek to accept because he had previously been quite hard on Keynes for his over-reliance on averages and aggregates and analysis. And so Hayek did not really have a satisfactory response to this criticism. And later on in the Pure Theory of Capital in 1941, Hayek further acknowledged that there was multiple natural rates of interest, but again tried to downplay the importance by saying there were tendencies for these natural rates to converge with one another, but at the same time that they could all exist, coexist with one another. And so Hayek accepts that there are multiple natural rates of interest, accepts the Sraffa critique. The Sraffa critique pointed out maybe more broadly some difficulties with, some empirical difficulties with the natural interest rate hypothesis. The first is that since for Knut Wicksell, the only thing we know about the natural rate of interest is whether it's above or below the market clearing rate, the equilibrium rate or the market rate, depending on whether we have price inflation or price deflation. It's only by seeing price inflation that we could make the statement that the natural rate of interest was above the market rate of interest, but we can't actually determine what the natural rate of interest is. It's an unobservable variable. Of course, the reason why it's an unobservable variable is because it's the rate of interest that it would obtain in a barter economy. And a barter economy hasn't existed for thousands of years, and so we don't actually know what the natural rate of interest is. All we can do is make estimates of it relative to the actual market rate of interest, given the appearance of inflation or deflation. Now, Sraffa's criticisms of Hayek were very damaging. They're still accepted by a lot of the mainstream, and even curiously, there are some Austrian school economists that believe that Hayek did not adequately respond to the multiple natural rates of interest criticism, which is especially unfortunate because Knut Wicksell anticipated this criticism and updated his own idea of the natural rate of interest in a work which was received by at least the English-speaking world too late to make a difference. In 1906, Knut Wicksell published his Lectures on Political Economy. And in the first volume of his Lectures on Political Economy, he makes the statement that savings-investment equilibrium would come about if we had a rate of interest, which was equal to a natural rate of interest, which was equal to what Wicksell calls the yield on newly created capital, which should make perfect sense. If the interest rate was set at the exact same yield as the newly created capital that we're trying to employ, savings and investment would be brought into equilibrium, and there would be no macroeconomic price pressures. There's really four advantages from this reformulation, which is consistent with his previous formulation, except reworded. The first advantage is that now the natural rate of interest is not an unobservable variable, because we know what the yield on newly created capital is. This is in stark contrast to his previous formulation of the natural rate, whereby it was just a barter rate of interest that would exist, but doesn't actually exist. The second key advantage, which is important for the Hayek-Sraffa debate, is that Hayek would not have been left with any methodological problem. Because again, one of Sraffa's most damning criticisms at the time was that Hayek relies on conditions that would exist in the barter economy to determine the conditions that should exist in the monetary economy, which is not done without severe problems. But when Wicksell reformulates his natural rate, now it's not just a barter rate of interest, it's something that we can actually see in the monetary economy. More to the point, when it's reformulated, the third advantage is that we no longer have multiple natural rates of interest. We don't have to rely on spot and future differences in specific commodity markets, but we can see what the marginal yield is on newly created capital in the investment market to gauge what the natural rate of interest is. And the fourth advantage is that now we have the missing link between the subsistence fund, the macroeconomic resource constraint governing the business cycle, and the signal that entrepreneurs receive in determining whether they should pursue or not an investment decision. Now, Wicksell's legacy on this point is a little bit spotty, because now when people talk about the natural rate of interest, they only talk about Wicksell's earlier work in 1898, Interest in Prices. This probably stems from the fact that his lectures on political economy, which came out in 1906, the first volume anyway, was only published in Swedish. And I guess if you want to make something as unavailable as possible, you publish it in Swedish. The Czech is probably also quite bad, and Hungarian and Polish, and you know. And the English translation didn't come until 1934 and 1935 for the two volumes. So there was an approximately 30-year gap in there. And by 1934 and 1935, when the English translation was available, it was much too late for the Sraffa-Hayek duels to take place. It was also not in time for Keynes. And remember that Keynes lamented when he reviewed Mises' original theory of money and credit, the German version in 1912, that because he couldn't speak German, what he was reading was mostly incomprehensible unless it was something that he already knew, which is probably an easy way to say that you don't speak German. And so Keynes was befuddled by many of the statements that Mises made in the theory of money and credit about interest rates. For example, Keynes didn't realize why Mises would make statements about knowing something about the rate of interest from the divergence between capital prices and consumer prices. But of course, this makes perfect sense if one considers the rate of interest, as Wicksell did, following in von Bawerk's footsteps, as just an intertemporal price spread between capital goods and consumer goods. And so Wicksell, in his new rendition of the natural rate, could have cleared this up, but I have doubts whether it was available to anybody who, I don't want to say matters, but anybody who was central in the business cycle debates in the 1930s at the time. Now, curiously, even within the Austrian School of Economics, I have only ever come across one person who refers Wicksell's second formulation of the natural rate of interest. And this is Murray Rothbard in his Man, Economy, and State. Every other Austrian school author that I've ever read makes reference only to Wicksell's earlier formulation of the natural rate, which is, again, a barter rate of interest that would exist if we didn't have a monetary economy. And Rothbard, in the course of Man, Economy, and State, I guess is 1,100 or 1,200 pages, only, curiously enough, makes reference to Wicksell's lectures on political economy. Doesn't even touch Wicksell's interest in prices. Because Rothbard himself realizes that starting from an assumption that the economy is barter and then trying to apply those conditions to a monetary economy is not without significant difficulties. Now, I want to conclude by just making a few brief and sundry comments about why this is important today. The importance of business cycle theory is really in determining what investments are sustainable or what patterns of investment are sustainable. The deeper question is, what guides an entrepreneur to make these judgments? Why would any entrepreneur undertake a sustainable versus an unsustainable investment? In the Austrian theory, it's the rate of interest that provides these signals and guides the entrepreneur accordingly. And in Austrian theory, as we've developed it here, it was the reliance on the original resource constraint through the subsistence fund that the interest rate serves its key role. It's not an interest rate as an interest rate, but is an interest rate as a price signal telling us how much or the degree to which resources have been pre-saved and made available for longer dated and more productive production processes. This is, again, in stark contrast, just to revisit the introduction from how the mainstream treats the interest rate, which is mostly not a real variable in any sense of the word. It's a variable which can be adjusted in various ways to try to bring about investment savings, to try to target full employment output, to keep inflationary pressures soft or increase them, as the case may be in many countries today. But the interest rate is not linked to the sustainability of an investment process or even a whole series of investment processes. In reducing the interest rate, the market rate of interest below the natural rate of interest, we can promote output, at least for a short period of time, but it will not be sustainably promoted. And so you can win the battle, but lose the broader war. And most importantly, just as a final comment on the matter, for most mainstream economists and central banks around the world, reducing the market rate of interest below the natural rate does not just lose the war, but it sows the seeds for its own destruction, which is surely what will happen eventually. Thank you.